I'm just going to pray real quick to get started and then start to share my story with you. So, God, I thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight. I thank you for these brothers and sisters in the body of Christ who are here together. Pray that I would handle your word with reverence and accuracy. And I pray that we would hear what you have to say to our hearts, or your Holy Spirit would just illuminate to us, and that we would be changed. I thank you for your love for us and your grace and the truth is at work in our lives and all you're doing. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. My name is Sam Johnson. As they introduced, I'm currently in the South Side of Chicago, and I just moved there recently. So I'll start off just by sharing a little bit of my story, my wife and I's story, and then share a little bit about our heart for the neighborhood that we're going to be serving in and planting a church in. And then I'll keep an eye on my watch. If there's any time left, I'll just share a little bit more about some of the things God used to bring us to this point. I always over-prepare, so I have notes for days, but I won't go. If we start getting too long, someone just visibly fall asleep, and then I'll know it's time to stop. But my wife and I both grew up in Tulsa, Oklahoma. That's where we're both from. And Tulsa is much different than Chicago. It's probably about 375,000 in the city and about 1 million in the metro. So it's a city, but it's nothing like Chicago. I grew up in the suburbs, and my wife grew up in a part of the city that's more like the suburbs. So we were used to big yards and lots of grass and things like that. And my family, both my parents grew up in communities like Metropolis. And so I spent a lot of time in communities like that in Oklahoma. So Chicago's a big, big difference from the way I grew up. And it's you know, that's been one of the adjustments that we've been making as God has called us to that. I grew up as the son of a pastor, an SBC pastor, so was around church life all the time, and as a result of that, didn't really want to be in the ministry at all. When you're in a minister's family, sometimes you see the good and the bad and the ugly too, and you know, and so I was one of those. I loved the Lord and I had a strong faith in the Lord, but I really was not planning on being in the ministry at all. So I went to college in Hawaii because I was an astronomy major, and they have a great program there. Plus it was Hawaii, so it was, you know, who wouldn't want to go to school there? And surprisingly not as expensive as I thought it was going to be, and had a great experience, really enjoyed being there, and was on track to go on to grad school. Astronomy is one of those careers that you have to go on and do doctoral work or you're not going to find a job. So I was on track to go on to grad school. And during my senior year in college was when the Lord really began to call me in the ministry and just showed me real clearly that while I could pursue another career and God would continue to bless me, that I wasn't going to really find fulfillment in that. That wasn't really what he had for my life. And so I said, okay, Lord, I'll change directions. I finished my bachelor's, moved back to Tulsa, got a job just working as an engineer, and started going to seminary. And worked in that job while I was going to seminary for about 3 years, and finished my MDiv, and then quit that job, which I was jokingly sharing with your youth pastor, Cliff, earlier. That was, you know, the highest paying job that I had had in my life until that point, and it's still the highest paying job I had. Ministry is not always a real high-paying job, but I quit that job and became a youth pastor and a bivocational youth pastor, and did that for 7 years until we moved here. Loved doing that, really enjoyed it. God grew me and my wife so much in that capacity, and we just really enjoyed working with young people. And we had always had missions on our heart. We felt like we would probably go overseas with the IMB. And we've, you know, as you can see in my life, most things don't work out how I think they're going to. Kind of like getting a BS in astronomy and then going into the ministry. And that was another one of those things. We thought, we'll probably do this for 2 or 3 years, and then we'll go overseas and do missions work. But we ended up being there longer than we thought, like I said, for 7 years. And during that time, God really, over a course of time, just played out a process in our heart that brought us to where we are now. And started really with giving us a burden and a heart for cities in America and some of the lostness in our cities, and also some of the need in our cities, both obviously spiritual need, but great physical need as well. That became a real burden on our hearts, and God did a lot of that through short-term missions. We would take our youth group on short-term mission trips, and I would kind of intentionally always take them to communities that were really struggling, communities that had a lot of needs. And God used that to burden our hearts. So we started praying, Lord, you know, please be at work in these communities. And we worked a lot with kids and young people, and our heart was broken by a lot of the things we saw in the lives of children and young people right here in the U.S. The physical poverty, the lostness, the just how far people were from the gospel, and all the other things, the abuse, the addictions, the violence, all those things that were just heartbreaking. So we began to pray, Lord, meet these needs, reach people, bring people to Christ, heal people, do things in their lives. And as we prayed that, we developed more of a burden for that. And so God began to say, yeah, I want to reach these people. I love these people. I want them to know about me. I want to engage them with the gospel. And I want to use you to do it. So we began to do that in Tulsa, where we lived. My wife, and she's not here tonight. I wish she was, because she's just an amazing woman. As I go on with the story, you realize just how amazing she is. But she's a certified teacher, so she taught school in Tulsa. And so she intentionally decided to teach in the inner city schools there in Tulsa, and we moved into that part of the city because we wanted to minister there and begin to engage the community there, begin to engage the community around our church. The church I served at was in a suburb, but right around the church there was a real needy area. So we began to engage that community and reached kids and young people in that neighborhood. And as we did that, God continued to increase that burden that he had more for us to do. And so a part of what we did while we were at that church, because we felt like this was a part of the calling God placed upon us, was we trained up other people, and a lot of them were young people, but adults as well from our church, to come in and take the roles that we were filling and continue the things that the Lord had started in that place. And because we knew that God was kind of pulling us on, and we didn't know where, we began to pray about it. Initially, we still thought overseas. Yeah, the Lord's going to take us, you know, to India, someplace like that. We have IMB missionaries in our family, in India and in South Africa. So that's where we were thinking. But God really redirected us and said, no, I want you to be engaged here. And so we started praying about different cities in the U.S., and the Lord kept bringing Chicago before our hearts. So 3 years ago, or 2 years ago, we made a trip to Chicago. It was our spring break. We weren't doing anything with the youth that week, and so my wife and I just made a trip, and didn't know anybody there. We weren't meeting up with a ministry at that point. We just went and visited the city and went around and prayed, and God really used that trip to really affirm the call that he'd been placing in our hearts to serve him in Chicago. And we saw a lot of the need there. So then we began to pray about what that meant. Were we supposed to pursue something with a church or with a ministry? And as I said, we both grew up in SBC churches. My dad was an SBC minister, and I always served in SBC churches. So I was very familiar with the North American Mission Board. And we contacted them and told them what our heart was. They said, great, Chicago is one of our strategic cities, and so we're looking for people to serve there. And so we began the process then of assessment and lining up all the ducks to be able to come and serve. And as Charles said earlier, that's how we met him at our final assessment. We met him and a bunch of other great servants from the state of Illinois. We really enjoyed our assessment time. And then that was in right around October, and we put our house on the market and packed up all our stuff and moved here, got here in mid-January. And then about 2 weeks after we got here, we had the 20-inch snowfall in Chicago. So we got baptized by snow into the city very quickly. And there's been a lot of adjustments there, not just the weather, but just, I was telling Charles earlier, just an adjustment to the density of the city. Where we came from in Tulsa, everybody had a yard, even if it was small. Even in the city, everybody had a yard. It's mostly single-family homes. Tulsa's not as old as Chicago, so you don't have all the multifamily dwellings. Even the apartments there are two or three stories, and they're spread out. They're complexes, not high-rises. And so just a lot of different things that we've been adjusting to. But God has continued to really affirm what he's doing in our lives, give us a love and a heart for the people there. And we are going to be planning in one of the far south neighborhoods, if you're familiar with Chicago. If you've driven into Chicago from here, you probably came in on Interstate 57. And if you come in on Interstate 57, there's a point where you're driving through the far south side of Chicago. Roseland, the neighborhood we're going to be planning in, starts at about 95th South and goes to about 115th South. So when you come in on 57 and you see those exits, 119th, 111th, there's one for Halsted and 95th. They're all right there before it joins up with 9094. That's the area we're going to be in. It's about 4.5 square miles, and about 45,000 people live in the neighborhood of Roseland. There's another neighborhood next to it called Morgan Park that we're also really praying and want to target that neighborhood as well. It's about 2.5 square miles with about 25,000 people. And in the south side, there isn't very much SBC presence at all. There's one other planter that I know of who's currently there and has a successful church plant that worked with NAM. And there's a couple other that are kind of coming online. But he's the only one in the south side right now. There's another NAM planter who's in a suburb called Dalton, which is just south of the city itself, so it's not too far. But there's not much SBC presence in the south side. There's great need. The Roseland neighborhood specifically is one of the most, it's one of the rougher neighborhoods in Chicago. It's really struggling. There's very high crime rate, a lot of violence in that neighborhood, a lot of, you know, illegal activity, and very depressed economy. No jobs, a lot of boarded up houses and empty buildings. The schools are struggling, just a lot of brokenness and need in that community. And that's the place that God called us to. As we began to pray about Chicago, we knew that God had called us to be involved in a community with needs. And so we began to pray about different neighborhoods. And Roseland was the one that God really brought before us. We went back multiple times and prayed through that because we were like, God, are you sure? We don't seem like a good fit at all to do ministry in this community. But that's the calling that God gave us. And so we said, okay, we'll do this. Roseland is a predominantly African-American community, so it's going to be cross-cultural ministry for us, and that's an important part of our apprenticeship, is learning how to do that, learning how to enter the neighborhood in the right way and do ministry in the right way in that context. But it's something that we're very excited about. We're very excited about what God's doing in our lives and what we pray that he will be able to use us to do. As I said, not because we're necessarily the ideal people to be there, but because God called us there and we said we'll go. And I guess for me, the heart of why we're church planters, because I've been involved with different ministries. We did a lot of ministry in Tulsa with different ministries. And there's so many great things that different ministries do. And I really prayed about that, Lord, you know, what do you want us to be a part of? There's so many ways to impact a community, so many ways to meet needs. And I think the biggest reason that we are church planters is because I believe with all my heart, and my wife does too, that the gospel changes people, that when people come to Christ, they can be reconciled to God, to their creator, to one another, and it will change their life. And we believe that. We believe that even in the worst places, the communities with the most struggle and the greatest need, that God wants to bring healing, and he does it one heart at a time. As a person is changed by the power of the gospel, a family is changed by the power of the gospel, a block, a neighborhood, a community is changed, a city can be changed, our nation can be changed. I really believe that, and that's why we're there, because it's a place with great need. It needs the gospel. People need to be changed. You don't have to spend very much time there at all to see brokenness, to see need and hurt and suffering and struggle. It's everywhere. But we really believe that the answer to that is the good news of Jesus Christ, and that God wants to reconcile men to himself through the grace of his Son. And so that's really why we're there. That's the process that brought us there. We're very new. Like I said, we just moved in mid-January, so we've only been there a couple of months. We're living a little bit in a community that's a little bit further north. It's on the south side. It's called South Shore, is the name of that neighborhood. And we have two little kids. As I said, my wife is an amazing woman. She has the same heart that I do and same vision. And so she was, if anything, she was more ready than I was to make this move. And she wasn't afraid. She's very comfortable with it. But we have our little kids that are there with us. Our daughter is 3.5, and our son is 1.5. So our kids are very young. And they make a quick adjustment. So they're already, you know, enjoying being there. And we're beginning to connect with people. As the slideshow said, I'm a church planting apprentice, which is a great place for me to be. It means for about the next year, I have a mentor that I meet with weekly. And then I also, one of my objectives is to learn, which is great because that's what I need to be doing, learn about the community, about the how to do ministry in the community, about the neighborhoods, and how to reach people, and spend time connecting with other pastors, with other people who are already doing work in the community. And so that's what I'm doing right now. We go out, we try to connect with our neighbors, we try to connect with people at the park, we try to share Christ with people, we spend time connecting with other pastors and other people who are doing ministry, we go to the community centers, we volunteer wherever we can. I'm going to be volunteering soon as a basketball coach. We're going to try to volunteer in the schools and just trying to reach people, begin to build relationships and share Christ with them and begin to hopefully fellowship with them. So that's kind of our story and what we're doing. And I just want to share a little bit of scripture with you. And these are some of the things that God used in my heart to answer this question of why church planting. As I said, I prayed through that. Why would we plant a church? Why is that something we should be doing? And as I talk about church, I'm just going to define that for you so we know what I'm talking about. There are many definitions of church, but for tonight, I'm going to be referring to a group of believers who are living out the mission of Christ in community and unity. And that's important because there are places in Chicago where there are churches. They are buildings and they have signs, but they may not be a group of believers. They may not be living out the mission of Christ. And so that's an important thing to consider. But one of the amazing things about the church is that the church is the only institution that holds the gospel. And that's a powerful thing to think about. If we think about the New Testament, one of the passages I have written down, because it's a passage the Lord used in my life, is Romans 10, verses 14 to 17. And this is where Paul gives us this series of logical statements that build on one another. about how the church needs to proclaim the gospel, about how we need to speak the gospel to those who haven't heard. And he says, how then shall they call upon him in whom they have not believed? And how shall they believe in him whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they preach unless they are sent? Just as it is written, how beautiful are the feet of those who bring glad tidings of good things. And verse 17 says, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing by the word of Christ. God gave this mission of sharing his word, his truth, to the church and to no one else. The church is the only institution that has the gospel, that holds the good news that God wants to reconcile man to himself, that it's possible through the grace of Jesus Christ, through the cross of Christ. Only the church knows that. Only the church gets to possess that. And that's a powerful truth. And if we think about some of the things that the church is commanded to do, some of the ways the church functions, we think about the worship of the church. The church is commanded to do this in the New Testament. We think about discipleship. One of the biggest, most important tasks of the church is to disciple and teach believers to observe the commandments of Christ. We think about nurturing families, which is such an important thing in the church, especially in the time we live when families are under attack. We think about the community strength that the church gives and the moral leadership that comes out of the church. All those things can only come from the church. And that's really a powerful truth for us to consider. Because people can find many places for entertainment. People can find a lot of places for education. They can find places for kind of self-improvement. They can even find a lot of places for inspiration, right? And that's not bad. Those are good things. It's good to be inspired. It's good to improve yourself. It's good to be educated and entertained. All those things are important. But there's only one place that people can hear the good news, that God wants to reconcile them to himself, and that because of the cross of Christ, it's possible for it to happen. There's only one place, and that's in the church. Such a powerful truth that's given to us. And I love that. There's a lot of good things we can talk about and do in church, but there's only one great thing. We only have one great message, and that is the message of the cross. The good news that God loves us and he's made a way for us to know him. The God who created us, the God who knew us from the beginning of time, that same Almighty God has made a way for us to know him. That's great news. It is the great message of the church, and people can't find that anywhere else. I love these words in John 6:68. This verse is just killing. This is Peter and Jesus talking here. In verse 66, it says, as a result of this, many of his disciples withdrew and were not walking with him anymore. This is some of the things that Jesus had just said that were very challenging to the disciples. Jesus said, therefore, to the 12, this is verse 67. Jesus said, therefore, to the 12, you do not want to go away also, do you? Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And that's a profound statement, probably even more profound than Peter realized. He said, where else are we going to go? You have the words of truth. You have the words of life. There is no other place to go. And that's important for us to wrap our minds around. Because people who don't know Christ are searching for truth, searching for hope. People are hurting. People are struggling. People are afflicted. Some of them don't know what they're looking for. Some of them know what they're looking for, but they don't know that it can be found in Christ. But they're not going to find it anywhere else. They're only going to find it in church, where the gospel comes from. There's no other organization or institution that shares the gospel. And that's powerful, powerful truth for us. What a great message God has given us. And to me, that was the first answer to why church planning? Why would I say, yeah, that's what I want to be involved in. That's what God is calling me to. It's the gospel. That's the thing that people are craving, whether they realize it or not. That's what's going to meet the deepest needs of their heart, and it's what's going to change their life and change their eternity after this life. And they can only get it one place. We know that it's also a biblical command, and that was another thing that was very powerful to my heart. We have the Great Commission in Matthew 28:18-20, where Jesus tells his disciples, I'll just read this to you. It says, and Jesus came up and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to observe all that I commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Jesus gives the church its great functions here of reaching people who don't know Christ, doing evangelism, and teaching them, building them up, teaching them to live a life that is right with God, discipleship. It's a command. Jesus tells us to do these things. And one of the greatest ways to do that is through church planting, like the slideshow says, where there are people who haven't heard, who don't know, who are in need. What better way than to begin a community of believers in their midst who can worship God together, who can reach the lost around them, and who can teach the people they reach how to live in right relationship with God. The need is really great, and that was another thing that God used to really drive home to me. Just going to read John 4:35. We all know this verse. Jesus said, Do you not say, there are yet 4 months and then comes the harvest? Behold, I say to you, lift up your eyes and look on the fields, that they are white for harvest. The need is great. The fields are more white than they've ever been. I can't say that in terms of readiness or ripeness because I can't really see how ripe things are. But I can say that just in terms of sheer numbers. There's more people on the earth than there's ever been. Our cities are bigger than they've ever been. The need is enormous. In terms of Chicagoland in particular, which includes the metropolitan area, so there's about 3 million people in the city, and then about 10 million in the metro. So when you talk about Chicagoland, includes about another 7 million people. But there's one SBC church for every 35,105 residents. So not a lot of SBC churches there. 42% of the population there are unaffiliated with any religious body, so they don't have any religious affiliation at all. And only 9.1% are affiliated with an evangelical church. These are statistics straight from NAM. And as it says, 9.1% are affiliated with an evangelical church. Affiliated, you know, that could mean a lot of things. That's not really, doesn't mean that those people are all coming to church each week and that they know Christ and that they're walking with him. But even if you said that was true, that's still less than 1 in 10 people who are fellowshipping with a church that speaks about the gospel. There are many, many people in Chicago who have never heard of Christ. And it sounds a little bit unbelievable, but it's totally true. There's so many international groups there, so many ethnic groups scattered throughout the city. Many of them don't have a witness in their group. They don't have someone sharing with them about the gospel. There's many neighborhoods that aren't ethnic. They are full of people who look like everyone in this room, but the gospel witness has withered in those neighborhoods, and there are people in those neighborhoods who don't know about Christ. Sounds unbelievable, but it's true. last week I was hanging out with another church planner. I was in a neighborhood on the northwest side of the city of about 45,000, and he said there's not a single evangelical church in his neighborhood. And there's quite a few neighborhoods like that. As I said, in the Southside neighborhoods, there are churches, but there's not a lot of gospel-focused churches. There's a lot of signs and buildings, and some of them are not healthy because they're not gospel-focused. They're not living out the mission of Christ, and some of them aren't even functioning. They're just a sign in a building, and no one shows up. So the need there is great. The city is full of neighborhoods with no healthy churches or with very few healthy churches. And I just to kind of give us a little perspective there on the density, the suburb I served in before this was about 16 square miles, I think, and had about 38,000 people. And it had grown real quickly. For a while, it was one of the fastest growing communities in the state. And there was probably, I don't know, it's hard to keep track because there was new churches all the time in that place. But there was probably like 70 churches there, 70 or 75, in that community of 38,000 people. And again, and the majority of those were evangelical churches. Again, these neighborhoods in Chicago, they're not as spread out. None of the neighborhoods are 16 square miles. A lot of them are between 1 and 4. But many of the neighborhoods have anywhere from about 40 to 70,000 people living in them. So you might walk around and occasionally see a church and think, oh yeah, there's a church in this neighborhood. You know, it's 3 or 4 blocks down. But when you consider the reality that there's 70,000 people living in the neighborhood, or 60 or 55, it's really not a lot of gospel witness in those places. So the need is very great there. NAM also talks about on their website some of the reasons for church planning. Evangelistic effectiveness, population growth, and I just think that's something good for us to consider. This is the church to population ratio in the U.S. peaked at one church for every 430 in World War I, but today there's only one church for every 6,200 people. So even if we were keeping everybody in church who is, you know, born here and is a part of the church as they're young, we still wouldn't be keeping up with the population. So there's great reasons to plant churches. And then the last thing NAM mentions is the different kinds of churches needed. And NAM says the gospel doesn't change, but our methods must be contextualized to the people we're reaching. And Chicago is a place where there's a lot of different churches needed, a lot of different communities and groups and people who have different cultural backgrounds and traditions, and they need churches planted in their communities that allow them to worship and hear the gospel right in the heart of their community in a way that they can hear it. And so that's a very important thing there. And then the last thing God just really brought home to me and impressed me with was just that we're building the kingdom of God. And that's one of the biggest reasons to plant churches. If I go into it with a mentality, with our youth, I used to call it empire building versus kingdom building. If I go into it with a mentality of I'm going to, you know, do this work and build this little empire over here, I'm going to offend other people and not do very much work for the kingdom. But if I'm humble and able to go into it and say, God, I'm here to build your kingdom. You tell me to do whatever you want, and I will do. We will start this Bible study with 2 people if that's what you're asking us to do. We'll meet in a basement. Whatever it is. And that's really what it's about. That's what church planning is about. It's about building the kingdom of God in the way that God puts before us to obey and to engage. I don't really know what that's going to look like for us at this point. I don't know that fully. I mean, there are things that we're praying, but I don't know what that's going to look like. But we know we want to serve, and we know we want to be available, and we know where God's called us to serve, and we have moved into that community, and we said, all right, Lord, we're here. You show us. You open some doors. You give us people to engage, and we're going to walk through it, and we're going to put all of our heart into it and see what you want to do. And if it's big, great, we'll praise you. If it seems small to us, that's fine too. We'll praise you and obey and serve. So you can pray for us as we're there, that God will really help us to continue to learn about doing cross-cultural ministry, that God will raise up people to serve alongside us. That's the biggest thing that I'm praying for right now, is that God will give us partnerships with people in the community, and specifically with African Americans who have been in the community, because we have a trust barrier. We're coming from the outside of the community. People don't know us. And so that's something we really want, is to partner with people in the community that we can build strong relationships with, and other people can look at them and say, hey, I trust that person, so I think I can trust these people. And then just pray that God will continue to lead us, and that he'll open the doors, and that we will have the courage to say, okay, Lord, that's the door you open. We're going to walk through that. And that we'll continue to be obedient, and we'll just leave the results to him, obey, and glorify him. Hopefully he can use us to build his kingdom, and God will get the glory, and that's our desire. So I really appreciate you letting me come, and I'm excited that you guys are here talking about church planting, because I think it's such an important part of God's kingdom, such an important part of the way God wants to work and is working right now. It's exciting. There are places in Chicago where God is working, and it's exciting to see. When you go, it gives you a faith boost. It's neat. It's exciting. And I'm excited about what God's doing in our lives and what he wants to do in that city. And I think that's just a powerful thing for us to consider, the truth that the gospel has been given to the church, that that's the only thing that can ultimately really change people's lives, and that it will change people's lives. The power of the gospel will change people's lives if they encounter it. So you can pray for my wife and I. Her name is Jessamine. Our kids are named Zakai, that's our daughter, and Zadok is our son. And I'm going to turn it back over to your pastor here.
All right. Thank you, Sam. We're going to pray for Sam in just a couple of moments, but I want us to think just a moment about, you know, we have all this week different church planters coming in, and people say, oh, my goodness, Pastor, why are we planting churches? We got hundreds of churches. We've got thousands of churches. Why do we need more churches? Well, it's because Jesus told us to go into the world and preach the gospel, and part of that task is sharing the gospel. I firmly believe this, that the answer to every single problem in the world is simple. It's the gospel. This is that simple. You're not going to solve it with politics. We look up north, and you know, we're down here on the southern end of the state. And so life is very different here than in Chicago. And sometimes we look up to the Chicago and we say, well, my goodness, you know, it's got crime, it's got all of these problems, and but the answer to that's not the government. The governor of Illinois doesn't have the answer. The state senators don't have the answer. The mayor of Chicago don't have the answers. But the gospel does. And so we need to preach the gospel in all of the world, in all of the places. And it's part of our Samaria, our Judea area. It's part of that wider area where we preach the gospel. But if you want to think it from a selfish standpoint, and you know, people say, why are we involved in church planting? Well, because Jesus told us to. That's the first and right answer. But the second answer is as we get involved in church planting, it blesses us. I'm going to tell you, I'll be honest with you, I don't know a church that's growing that's not involved in church planting today. I really don't. Every church that I talked to, I was down at Jacksonville a few weeks ago, and we were talking to pastors, and the church there at Jacksonville, they're one of the largest churches in the Southern Baptist Convention. They were talking about their church planting and what they're doing, and God uses it. But it's a source of blessing. It's a source of an opportunity for God as we go and we're on mission and we're sharing the gospel. You know what happens? Every time we've been involved in it, you know what happens? We've received more blessings than we've given. We've been to Haiti. We receive more out of that partnership than we've given to it. Not monetarily, maybe not numerically, but there's better things in the world than money and numbers sometimes. There are other blessings that come around. And so as we get involved in this, we want to continue to preach the gospel and to share and to get involved. And I hope you'll come by and meet Sam and talk to him and just get to know him a little bit and to hear his heart and the things to do. And just, do you have some prayer cards? Did you have to bring some prayer cards? All right. Well, he didn't. All right. But write his name down. Grab Alex's prayer card out there from yesterday and write Sam's name down on it and keep it before you and make it a habit to daily pray for these church planters and the work they're doing. I mean, think about that. These are the heroes. These are my heroes of the faith. You say, well, who are the guys that that you look up to in the ministry? I'll be very honest with you. It's our missionaries and our church planters. We may never hear them. They probably, you know, maybe never have a television broadcast or a radio broadcast. We may never subscribe to their podcast, but I'm telling you, these guys are doing more work for the kingdom than oftentimes some of the biggest name preachers in the country. That's where God is working. So you guys are our heroes, and we're glad that you're out there serving in places that, I'll be honest with you, he was describing the neighborhood today. I thought, whew, man, I just be honest. Can I just be honest with you for a minute? I was like, man, I'm glad God called him to that, not me. You know what I'm saying? I'm not a city guy at all, but God calls people out to serve, and our job is to hold the rope and help them get the job done. Amen? And let's give Sam a round of applause. Let him know we love him, and thank you for coming tonight. And he's driving a long ways to share with us for a short time, all right? And so you come by. Make sure you go by. I'm going to have him come out in the vestibule there. Come by and encourage him and let him know you're going to pray for him. And we're going to pray for him and his family right now, all right? That's how we're going to close the service tonight. I just want to invite you, if you haven't been involved in one of our mission trips, whether it's a foreign mission trip or one of our local state mission trips, and God is dealing with you about that, come and go. Maybe God's saying, hey, my mission for you is right here in Metropolis, because bloody, there's lots and lots of lost people. We don't have, you know, we're a lot smaller town. I was thinking about that for a moment. Think about the size of the town that he's just talking about. How far is it from Big John's to Little Tractors? About how many miles would that be? Four? Three miles, Cliff says. If we can trust Cliff's measurement, all right, say 3 miles. How far is it from the river to, say, North Avenue? Straight line from the river to North Avenue. 2 miles, maybe? 2 miles? That's about the area you're talking about. There's roughly 6,500 people in that spot that I just roughly, about 6,500 people. How many did you say were in that same spot? 45,000. How many churches? Evangelical churches. Not a single SBC church. In that area that we just talked about, there's what? Four? There's us, Emmanuel, Eastland. And there's several other, there's a couple independent Baptist churches in there. There's an African-American Baptist church. Do you get what I'm saying? In for a town of 6,500, we've got an amazing number of churches. They've got a town of about roughly the same geographic size, 45,000 people, zero evangelical witness. That puts it in perspective for me of just how many people are stacked in there. I can imagine 45,000 people in our town. That'd be the biggest Superman festival we've ever had. All right, let's all stand and let's have a word of prayer and close out tonight. Sam, why don't you come down here with us? Cliff and Charles, you go ahead and come on down, and we're just going to pray for these guys. And make sure you get to talk to Charles, too. Charles is one of our really, really fine IBSA staff members and does a great job. And so we want you to get to know him while you're down. He's kind of working more on the afternoons, but make sure you get a chance to talk to him. All right, let's just come and put our hands on Sam. Let's pray for him. Father, we thank you for this day. We thank you for your blessings. Lord, we thank you for the gospel. The gospel that tells us about how we can be reconciled. Even though we're sinful human beings, we can be reconciled to you through the death of your son, Jesus. And Father, we stop and we look at all the world's problems and all the difficulties, all of the challenges facing the world. And Lord, we've got the greatest news. We've got the only hope for the world. And Father, I pray tonight for Sam and his family. I pray that as they go and work there in the south side of Chicago, Father, in a very difficult and challenging environment, Father, I pray that you would guide them, lead them, encourage them, Father. I pray that you would strengthen them for the task and give them wisdom. And Lord, I pray that you'd bless the efforts there, Father. And I pray that as a church, Lord, we would take it seriously, that we've been called not to just sit here in our city, not to just sit and bask in your blessings, but Father, to be a source of those blessings, to be a channel through which you bless the nations, Father, with the gospel. And so, Father, we pray that you would lead and guide us and lead and guide him as we seek to reach our state with the good news of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.